Hello children, welcome to online video classes. In the last video, we discussed regarding the last class of algae, that is Rhodophyceae, its examples and also the economic importances of the algae. In today's class, we are talking regarding the next class of plant kingdom, that is class Bryophyta. We'll discuss regarding the next class of plant kingdom, that is Bryophyta. What are bryophytes, where they are found, how do they reproduce, everything will be discussed in class Bryophyta. Remember, bryophytes are the plants which are the first to inhabit in the terrestrial conditions. Remember, they are the first plants to get adapted on the land condition. Why? Because before bryophytes, we have discussed algae, wherein all the three algae were adapted to aquatic habitat. Hence, I said the bryophytes are the first organisms or the first plants to inhabit in the terrestrial condition. And usually, where you find, you have understood, but as I told you, they are terrestrial plants, but whether they are vascular plants or non-vascular plants. Remember, the bryophytes are non-vascular plants, means they do not have vascular tissues, means they don't have xylem and phloem. They are terrestrial habitat. They don't have vascular tissues, means they are non-vascular plants, that is absence of xylem and phloem. And usually these plants have dominant gametophytic plant body, or multicellular plant body is the gametophytic plant body on which sporophytic plant body is depending. Remember, in the bryophytes, the main plant body is gametophyte. Main plant body is haploid gametophyte, which is free living photosynthetic, on which the sporophytic plant body is depending. Because in bryophytes, the sporophytic plant body is not free living, but it is parasitic on the gametophytic plant body. Usually, the bryophytes includes two group of plants. It includes two main group of plants like mosses and liverworts. It includes two main group of plants like mosses and liverworts. Where they are usually found growing? They are usually found growing in the moist places. Moist means water holded regions. They are found growing in the moist places, particularly in the shaded regions. Shaded means where there is no enough sunlight is falling. Shaded places, usually you find bryophytes are growing in the hilly regions or on the hills. Remember, The bryophytes are usually found growing in the moist, shady places in the hills. And remember, usually I said you, they are terrestrial habitat. They are showing terrestrial habitat, but even then they are called as amphibians of the plant kingdom. They are called as the amphibians of the plant kingdom. Why they are called as amphibians of the plant kingdom? Because even though they live on the land, they need water for sexual reproduction. Even though they live on land, they need water for sexual reproduction. Hence we say the bryophytes are amphibians of the plant kingdom. Here you can see some different beautiful bryophytes displayed on the screen. As they appear beautiful, even their characteristic is still more beautiful, because even though they live on land, they require water for fertilization. Let us study the next characteristic of the bryophytes. Remember, the plant body of the bryophytes is more differentiated when you compare to algae. In the previous class, you have studied regarding algae, where the plant body was not well differentiated. But in the bryophytes, the plant body is well differentiated. And it appears either thallus-like, or sometimes you can see some bryophytes which are prostrate. Prostrate means the plant body growing horizontally. The plant body growing horizontally, we call it as prostrate. But there are some bryophytes which grow erect. Erect means straight. Remember, there are some bryophytes, even you can find the plant body is erect. Means they are growing vertically. And how they are attached to the substratum? Means how the plant body of bryophytes is attached or sticked to the substratum. Remember, the bryophytes are attached to the substratum with the help of unicellular root-like structures called rhizoids. They are attached to the substratum with the help of unicellular root-like structures called rhizoids. And remember, I am telling root-like structures. Why not directly roots are mentioned here? Because remember, the bryophytes do not have true leaves, true stem, or true roots. Means they have root-like, stem-like, leaf-like structures, but they don't have true leaves, true stem, or true roots. Why so? Because these structures, they do not have vascular tissue. Complete plant body do not have vascular tissue, and we don't find the vascular tissues in the root, stem, or leaf. Hence we say they have root-like, stem-like, leaf-like structure. And What is the plant body? What type of plant body is the bryophyte having? As I told you, the main plant body or the dominant phase of the plant body in the bryophyte is haploid gametophytic plant body. Haploid gametophytic plant body. Haploid gametophytic plant body is the dominant plant body in the bryophytes, and the main function of the gametophytic plant body is to produce the gametes. Because the gametophytic plant body will be having the sex organs. Hence they are involved in producing the gametes required for sexual reproduction. Remember, the main plant body, as I said you, gametophyte in the bryophytes. But when you take other group of plants like pteridophytes, gymnosperms, angiosperms. Among all these plants, including bryophytes, if you consider, bryophytes are the one group of plants which have large gametophytic plant body. Means among all these group of plants, the bryophytes have larger gametophytic plant body because it is the dominant plant body. Remember, in the bryophytes, the gametophytic plant body is the dominant plant body. Hence, we say usually it is one of the larger gametophytic plant body bearing class. Like this, we say bryophytes are the group of plants which have larger gametophytic plant body. And remember, in bryophytes, gametophytic plant body is the dominant one and have the sex organs to produce the gametes. But remember, the sex organs present on the gametophytic plant body are multicellular. They are multicellular. And which is the male sex organ you find on the gametophytic plant body? The male sex organ present on the gametophytic plant body is antheridium. The male sex organ present on the gametophytic plant body is antheridium, which is involved in the production of male gametes. Which are the male gametes produced? The male gametes produced in bryophytes are antherozoars, which are actually biflagellated. Remember, the male gametes are antherozoids, which are biflagellated, and we can also call them as ciliated sperms. And remember, usually, how is the female sex organ? Female sex organ is archegonium. Archegonium is a female sex organ which appears flask-shaped structure. And produces the female gamete. In the archegonium, the female gamete, that is single egg, is produced as a female gamete within the flask-shaped archegonium. Hence, male sex organ is antheridium.
female sex organ is archegonium. Then how the fertilization takes place? I told you the bryophytes are adapted to land but need water for fertilization. How actually? Now you will understand. Remember, the male sex organ, that is antheridium, releases the male gametes called antherozoids in the water. Remember, the antherozoids are released in the water and through the water current they come in contact with the archegonium, within which you can find the female gamete. Within which you can find the female gamete. But remember one important thing. Archegoniate structure, what we are talking about, you find these archegoniate structures within bryophytes, pteridophytes and gymnosperms, but not in angiosperms. Remember, the archegoniate which we find, or which I have told, in bryophytes, they are also found in pteridophytes, even in gymnosperms, but you don't find them in the angiosperms, and also they are absent in the archaea. Even you don't find these archegoniate structures within the algae and angiosperms. You can see the figures showing the antheridium and archegonium. Remember, you can see the diagram or the figure displayed on the screen, which is showing antheridium and archegonium on the male thallus and female thallus. This was all about antheridium and archegonium. That is, what the male sex organ is and what the female sex organ is called as. How the fertilization takes place? The male sex organ, that is antheridium. The male sex organ, that is antheridium, produces the male gametes called antherozoids in the water. Through the water, the antherozoids reach the archegonium and enters into the archegonium, where it find the female gamete, that is egg. The male gamete antherozoid fuses with the female gamete, that is egg, to form the diploid zygote. To form the diploid zygote. This is, we call it as fertilization, where it has utilized the water medium for transferring the gametes. Where it has used the water medium for transferring the gametes. Hence I said bryophytes need water for sexual reproduction. Soon after the zygote is formed, it will not undergo meiotic division. Soon after the zygote is formed, it will not undergo meiotic division to produce the haploid spores, as we see in algae. Remember, in bryophytes, the zygote will not immediately undergo reductional division, but it will divide to form the multicellular sporophytic diploid plant body. It will grow into diploid sporophytic plant body. After fertilization, the zygote which is formed, it will divide and develop into multicellular diploid sporophytic plant body. But remember one important thing, as I said initially, the sporophytic plant body, even though it is multicellular, it is not photosynthetic, means it cannot carry out photosynthesis. Hence we say it is not free living. In bryophytes, the sporophytic plant body, even though it is diploid, even though it is multicellular, it is not free living and it is not photosynthetic. Then how it gets its nutrition? It gets its nutrition by depending on the gametophytic plant body, because the main plant body in bryophytes is gametophytic plant body, which is photosynthetic. Remember, in the bryophytes, the sporophytic plant body is a diploid, multicellular, but it is not free living, it is non-photosynthetic, but it is completely depending on photosynthetic gametophytic plant body for its nutrition. Remember, the sporophytic plant body is diploid, which is formed from the zygote after fertilization. Once the sporophytic plant body is formed, which is multicellular and found attached on the gametophytic plant body, which you can see in the figure. Remember, the sporophytic plant body, once it is formed from the zygote, it is found attached on the gametophytic plant body and gets the nourishment from the gametophytic plant body. Once the sporophytic plant body is formed, some of the cells in a sporophytic plant body undergo meiotic division to produce haploid spores. Remember, after the sporophytic plant body is formed, it will produce the spores. From what they produce the spores? Some of the cells of sporophytic plant body, they undergo meiotic division or reductional division to produce haploid spores. When these spores are completely developed, matured, they are released out. When these haploid spores are completely developed, completely matured, they are released from the sporophytic plant body. They are dispersed in their surrounding. These spores are dispersed in their surrounding and under suitable conditions, once the condition is favorable, these spores will germinate to give rise to new plant body. These spores will germinate to give rise to new plant body. But as I told you, the spores are haploid. Hence, the plant body which is forming will be haploid. And the haploid plant body in the bryophyte is gametophyte. Hence, on the germination of haploid spores, a haploid gametophytic plant body is formed. Haploid gametophytic plant body is formed, which is the dominant plant body. Remember, during fertilization, the antheridium releases male gametes in the water. Through the water medium, it will reach the archegonium. Archegonium is a flask shaped containing single egg cell, which is a female gamete. The male gamete, that is antherozoid, fuses with the female gamete to form the diploid zygote. But I told you the zygote will immediately not undergo meiosis to produce the haploid spores. Then what happens? The zygote will develop into the multicellular sporophytic plant body. But the sporophytic plant body remains attached to the gametophytic plant body, because the sporophytic plant body is non-photosynthetic and it is not independent. Hence, it is found attached on the gametophytic plant body for nutrition. Some of the cells of sporophytic plant body undergo meiotic division to produce haploid spores. And these haploid spores, once they are released, under favorable conditions, they germinate to produce haploid plant body, that is gametophytic plant body. Like this, we call it as alternation of generation. That is, gametophytic plant body producing gametes fuse to form zygote. Zygote develops into sporophytic plant body. The sporophytic plant body undergoing meiosis produces spores which are haploid, and those spores will germinate again to give the gametophytic plant body. Gametophytic plant body giving rise to sporophytic plant body. Sporophytic plant body giving rise to gametophytic plant body. This is an alternation of generation which is seen in the bryophytes. These are all the general characteristics of bryophytes, where we have seen where they are found adapted, how is the plant body, what are the sex organs, how the fertilization takes place, how do they produce the spores. Next, we have to discuss the economic importances and also the ecological importances. Means, what are the important uses of the bryophytes? We'll understand the importances of the bryophytes. In that, first we'll study how economically the bryophytes are useful. Remember, economically, bryophytes are of less use. Let us study one by one. Usually, the bryophytes are used as the source of food. They are used as the source of food by most of the mammals, birds, and even some of the animals. Remember, they are used as the source of food by some of the group of animals, like you can take mammals, birds, and also some other group of animals. This is the first economic use of the bryophytes. The second important economically valuable use of bryophytes is, remember, there are some group of bryophytes called mosses. Particularly, one moss called spanum. Spanum is a type of moss coming under bryophyte, produces an economically valuable product called peat, which you can see in the picture. Remember, spanum produces, which is a moss, produces the economically valuable product called peat, which is used commercially as a fuel. It is used commercially as a fuel. Not only that, remember, the peat is having the capacity of holding the water or retaining the water. It is having the capacity of retaining the water. Hence, it is used for the packaging and transportation of living materials from one place to another place. Usually, they are having the retainability of the water. The peat is having the capacity of holding the water. Hence, it is used for packaging and transporting the living materials from one part to another part. These are the two economic uses or importances of the brine fines. Now let us study how ecologically the brine fines are useful. Ecologically, the bryophytes play a very important role because bryophytes along with the lichens are the first organisms, or we can say they play an important role in the ecological succession. What is ecological succession? Means they help to initiate the growth of them on the bare land or bare rocks. Bare land or bare rocks. As you see in the picture, where you can see the organism, that is bryophyte, is growing on the stone. Means they play an important role in ecological succession along with the lichens. Remember, the mosses particularly of bryophytes along with the lichens, they grow on the rock. First they start growing on the rock, they start colonizing on the rock. Slowly the rock start withering, means it start making the soil. Once the soil is started forming on the rocks, it allows the growth of other organisms. But the mosses along with the lichens are the first organisms to grow on the bare rocks or bare soil. Hence, they play a very important role in the ecological succession. Not only that, the second ecological importance is, as I said you, they colonize on the rocks and hence they help in making the suitable medium by producing the soil for the growth of other organisms or for the growth of higher plants, maybe like pteridophytes, after that gymnosperms, and some small angiosperms, and finally leading to the formation of a forest community. Remember, the mosses which are growing on the bare rocks helps in forming the substrate which is required for the growth of other group of plants. This is the second ecological importance. What is the last ecological importance of the bryophytes? Remember, usually Once the bryophytes they start growing on the soil, they form a thick or we can say dense mat on the soil. They cover a huge area and forms a complete mat on the soil. What is the benefit of growing the bryophytes on the soil? It holds the soil very tightly so that it will avoid or it will prevent the soil erosion and the falling rain. Remember, it will prevent the soil erosion which is taking place due to the heavy rainfall. Soil erosion means flooding away the upper layer of soil. If once the upper layer of soil is flooded away, it will not allow the growth of other organisms or other plants. Hence, the topmost layer of the soil is essential, which is held tightly by the bryophytes, particularly mosses. These are the ecological importances of the bryophytes. This completes some characteristics of bryophytes and their importances. In the next video, we'll discuss regarding the two group of plants included in bryophytes. They are liverworts and mosses. So in my next video, I'll come up with the new classes of bryophytes, that is liverworts and the mosses. See you in next video.